In 1865, Rochester was approaching the end of its time, known as a frontier town. Although the completion of the Erie Canal in 1824 had significantly impacted Western migration and put Rochester on the map, the Transcontinental Railway was yet to come. The population of Rochester had grown to 60,000 people, over half of whom were employed in manufacturing, the other half in trade, transportation, and other professions. There were even a few farmers who held on to their land as the city grew. And at that time, there were six means of transportation. Steam-powered trains came to Rochester in 1837, when the first steam locomotive departed from Rochester for Batavia. That locomotive was delivered to Rochester by canal boat, as there were no tracks east of the city. And in 1853, five railroads that led out of Rochester consolidated into the New York Central. A thriving city had other forms of transportation in the form of hacks, a forerunner to the present-day public bus system and school buses. It's hard to imagine, but the bicycle was in its infancy at the time. Rochester continued to be serviced by stagecoaches. Pictured here is the Abbott Downing stagecoach, which was used primarily in the eastern regions of the country. In its infancy was the horse-drawn railway. One of the first lines ran from the Four Corners, Buffalo Street, Main and State Street north to Lake Ontario. If you were to look at a picture of downtown Rochester in that era, you would see farm wagons, buggies, and in the winter, sleighs all mixed in with bicycles, horse-drawn cars, and pedestrians. One would also encounter canal packet boats being towed through the middle of Rochester on the viaduct that bridged the Genesee River. It is likely that the year 1865 would not soon be forgotten by the people of Rochester and the surrounding areas. Many big events happened in that year. On March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, there wasn't a parade. Instead, Rochester suffered one of its greatest floods, with the Genesee River breaching its banks and leaving as much as 4 to 5 feet of water on Front Street and the Four Corners of State and Buffalo. Just weeks later, on April 6th, General Lee and General Grant met to sign an agreement that would end the 4-year-long Civil War. Not unlike cities all across the country, local newspapers recorded that there were great celebrations with church bells ringing out on the streets of Rochester. And in the weeks and the months that followed, sons, brothers, and fathers began returning home. On April 15th, President Lincoln was assassinated at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C. Again, like people across the land, Rochesterians' grief and fear returned to people's hearts. It was on April 27th that, in spite of the extensive damage that resulted from the St. Patrick's Day flood only a month before, hundreds of Rochesterians stood silently as the New York Central Rail Station at 3 o'clock in the morning as President Lincoln's funeral train passed slowly through Rochester. It is in this setting that we discover, among some other denominational churches, that there were only three Baptist churches, First Baptist, Second Baptist, and the First German Baptist Church. In many an instance, as the Baptist movement spread across the country west of the Allegheny Mountains and on to the West Coast, Sabbath schools, or Sunday schools, were established in new villages and towns. These schools were often established in city neighborhoods that did not have an organized church. Many would result in the formation of a church. This begins the prelude for Lake Avenue Baptist Church.
Thank you.
In 1826, the Rochester Sunday School Union was formed, and by 1865, several Sunday schools had been formed. Two on the west side of the river, north of city center, were staffed and partially funded by First Baptist Church. One was located at Hanford's Landing, and the other at Deep Hollow. Deep Hollow was a deep ravine that carried a meandering creek down to the Genesee River, about where the former Topps Market and Dunkin' Donuts stand today. The dirt road at the time crossed the hollow on a narrow wooden bridge that played an important role in the War of 1812. The Deep Hollow Sabbath School Mission originally met in what is described as the Old School, which was most likely one iteration of School Number 7. From there, it moved to a small Presbyterian chapel on the east side of Lake Avenue, which burned in 1864. The mission then moved to the new schoolhouse, School Number 7. And in 1865, the school board forced the Sabbath School out of the building, which could have caused the mission school to close its doors. However, First Baptist Deacon Orrin Sage, who had purchased a property between Jones Street and Ambrose Street at Lake Avenue, immediately stepped up and said to the church, "If you will arise and build, the land is at your service," toward putting up a suitable memorial mission chapel. The new chapel building was dedicated in memoriam to peace on March 2, 1866, and opened 2 days later on the 4th for Sunday school and evening preaching. The chapel was built as a thank you offering for the return of peace after 4 long years of civil strife. It was also intimated that it was a thanksgiving for the fact that not one life was lost in the Great Flood of 1865. The Sunday school classes were held on Sunday afternoon, as they were led by lay teachers from First Baptist Church, who likely taught classes there in the morning. In the words of Deacon Orrin Sage from March 1, 1866, "Then with settees from the rear room, seats for the infant class, chairs for the pulpit, hymn books for the congregation, and a Sabbath school worthy of the place, the little Union Sabbath school which was so ruthlessly turned out can here find a new home." In 1850, a group of professors were dismissed from the Colgate College School of Theology to move to Rochester. This was a move in anticipation of the Industrial Revolution, thinking that young men needed training for ministry in industrialized urban areas. Once in Rochester, they founded the University of Rochester and the Rochester Theological Seminary. The first theological student to be trained for ministry in the urban area was Mr. William M. Lisley, who preached at Lake Avenue Mission from March 1866 to May 1867. Robert Stuart MacArthur, the second mission preacher from January 1868 to May 1869, graduated from the University of Rochester in 1867 and Rochester Theological Seminary in 1870. Ordained in Rochester the same year, he was called to become pastor at Calvary Baptist Church in New York City. That pastorate lasted 41 years. In 1906, he took a politically and socially unpopular stance against the Bronx Zoo, which was exhibiting a diminutive black man who was caged with the monkeys. He aligned himself with the black clergy of the city, and they managed to stop the exhibit. When he retired, he was named Pastor Emeritus, but gave up the title in 1921 to avoid association with the sensationalism of the new pastor at Calvary, and he died in Florida in February 1923. The third mission preacher, from July 1869 to April 1870, was Albert Coit. Mr. Coit graduated from the University of Rochester in 1866 and from Rochester Theological Seminary in 1869, and upon graduation, he became the associate pastor of First Baptist Rochester, followed by 18 years as pastor of First Baptist Church, Wellsville, New York. He also served Mount Olivet Baptist in Syracuse and was active in numerous state Baptist entities and was a strong prohibitionist. Reverend Coit died in Syracuse on June 8, 1920. The fourth student to preach the evening services at Lake Avenue Mission was David Downey. Mr. Downey was preaching at the mission when the mission was formed into a chartered church to be known as the Lake Avenue Baptist Church. Years later, Reverend Downey published a book entitled From Mill to Mission Field, in which he relates this, quote, "The pastor of the First Baptist Church, Henry Robbins, did not want the church organized here." Note that later Reverend Robbins left First Baptist and became president of Colby Baptist College in Maine in 1873. Mr. Downey and Deacon Waite thought it should be, and they thought that God thought so too, that it was. Another of the deacons told him that he was not big enough to be pastor, but that they would elect him clerk. So Mr. Downey served as the clerk of the church for the first 7 months of its existence. And in 1863, Reverend Downey sailed to the mission field in India, where he spent years and years serving on the mission field, and he became one of the most respected missionaries in all of India. And it is with this that we have transitioned from that which came before to that which has become Lake Avenue Memorial Baptist Church. On April 26, 1871, the trustees of the First Baptist Church of Rochester moved and passed the following motion: resolved that the trustees be authorized and directed to execute to the organization known as the Lake Avenue Memorial Baptist Church and Society of Rochester a quitclaim deed of the property known as the Memorial Mission belonging to the church and society when they have been duly recognized according to the usage of the denomination. On July 19, 1882, the trustee minutes report that the pastor was empowered to appoint a selection committee of three to make a special canvass for the purpose of raising the funds of $26,000, the estimated expense for the erection of our contemplated church. And it was then, on 1816-1882, that the committee had raised $17,445, of which $11,000 was set aside to build the rear portion of the new church edifice. A building committee was elected, and the rear portion would be built behind the mission chapel. It is here that we see a picture of the building taken from what is now Fulton Street. It is here that we see the picture of the building taken from the Ambrose Street side. It was on March 2, 1884, that the Lake Avenue Baptist Church Sunday School held a farewell service, indicating the move from the Mission Chapel into the rear building, having been recently completed. On May 27, 1884, the trustees moved and seconded that the brick chapel be donated to the Rochester Baptist Missionary Union for church purposes, providing it be erected on or near Lyle Avenue. And it was in 1884 that the chapel was dismantled brick by brick and moved to Cameron Street and rebuilt as a mission church to start that which has become the Lyle Avenue Baptist Church. The building that you see here might be familiar to many of you because it now serves as the home base of Cameron Community Ministries. On September 21st, 1888, the object of a special meeting of the trustees was the new church building. it was revealed that the deed transferring the Sage property to First Baptist contained a clause that forbade placing a mortgage on the property. The solution was to engage legal counsel to obtain a quick deed from each of the Sage heirs. Just a couple of months later, the trustees dropped the issue of a new building due to the lack of pledges for the project. On November 2, 1889, all funds for the new church building had been raised. So the trustees declared, "When we build the front of the church, all funds received shall be called the A.J. Barrett Memorial Fund, and that we begin to build this church ground to be broken as soon as the frost is out of the spring, and it shall be completed before the snow flies in the fall." Here you see the new church building during the day. And here is the new church building at night. It was on February 10th, 1891, that the new church building was finally dedicated. We are blessed to hold a variety of pictures of that church building here from the Jones Street side. And inside, you'll see the church sanctuary with the chancel in the southwest corner. And the auditorium entrance and the gallery in the northeast corner. In that day, the Sunday school was an entirely separate entity within the church. They collected their own offerings, managed their budgets, had elected officers and constitutions. Note that in the balcony, there are rods with curtains behind the pillars, which would be pulled to divide the space into classrooms usually used for adult classes. Sunday school began in the Sunday school chapel with an opening exercise, which included the children. They then broke into separate classes, but would return to the chapel for closing exercises before dismissal. Keeping stomachs full was food prepared in the church kitchen, then located in the basement. And bodies were kept warm by the janitor and others in the boiler room stoking the fire. On January 28, 1896, a meeting was called to discuss and recommend that the church improve the gallery. It would cost $4,500. By just the next day, the church had raised $6,500. There was discussion to review the plans, and then it was built. And by September 20th, a service was held for the enlarged auditorium. If all of these things happened in just 30 short years, imagine what is to come. Following the service of David Downey as the last of their mission pastors, Lake Avenue Baptist Church called the first of their pastors, Reverend Ebenezer Nisbet. Nisbet was born in Edinburgh, Scotland, on June 20, 1826. He attended the University of Rochester starting in 1853, then Rochester Theological Seminary, graduating in 1856. While serving in New York, he was a member of the New York Baptist Union for Ministerial Education, and in 1886, his book, The Science of the Day and Genesis, was published, following shortly The Resurrection of the Body, which was published the same year. Following the tenure of Reverend Dr. Nisbet, Lake Avenue Baptist Church called Reverend Dr. A. Judson Barrett. Born in Kingsville, Ohio, Barrett, at the age of 18, had his sights set on the new university in Rochester and traveled by stagecoach to Erie, Pennsylvania, and a steamer to Buffalo. He enrolled as a sophomore and graduated in 1854 and immediately began a teaching career at the Nunday Academy as principal. In 1868, he became principal of the Kingsville Academy until 1871. From Kingsville, he took a teaching position at the Lowville Academy, and then from there he came back to Rochester to assume the position of the principal of the Rochester Collegiate Institute. During his 2 years at the Institute, he pursued his degree at Rochester Theological Seminary and was called to LABC in 1876. Despite this exciting time of growth, he died Sunday, October 20th, 1889, while walking to the church from his Fulton Avenue home. He collapsed and died near the corner of Emerson and Fulton Avenue. He had preached in the morning, attended a funeral in the afternoon, and was in his usual good spirits before heading to the church. His ministry was carried on in the immediate weeks to follow by his daughter, Helen Barrett Montgomery, who the church had licensed to preach. After Dr. Barrett died, during the 2 years to follow as the church looked for a new pastor, Dr. Harwood Pattison served as the interim pastor. He was born in Cornwall, England. After a short time as an architect, he entered Regent's Park Baptist College, which was formed in a time when other colleges would only accept members of the Church of England. It became a dissenting college. Pattison served several Baptist congregations in England before he moved in 1874 to the United States and immediately secured a position with the First Baptist Church of New Haven, Connecticut. After serving in New Haven, he moved to take the pulpit at Emmanuel Baptist Church in Albany, New York, and then came to become the homiletics professor at the Rochester Theological Seminary. It was in 1891, during his senior year at Rochester Theological Seminary, that Clarence A. Barber came to Lake Avenue Baptist Church. It is here that you see the card that holds the resolution to call Dr. Barber to the pastoral ministry of Lake Avenue Baptist Church. Dr. Barber was deeply engaged in the work of the community in Rochester, and it was during this time that the sanctuary went through a new decoration with new singing books and special music. In 1909, Dr. Barber resigned his pastorate at LABC to become the Associate Director of the Religious Work Department of the International Committee of the YMCA in New York City. However, not long after, in 1915, Dr. Barber was called as the President of the Rochester Theological Seminary. During his tenure, the seminary enrollment grew, the faculty was strengthened, the endowment enlarged, and the seminary's renown as a progressive school of ministry spread. On October 18, 1929, Brown University inaugurated Dr. Barber as the president of the university from which he had graduated, and at age 70, he died on January 16, 1937. As immigrants from the old countries began to move west across what would become the United States, they carried their Protestant faith with them, and in many places where a church did not exist, Sabbath schools were developed. In 1865, Deacon Sage of the Rochester First Baptist Church gave land and initial funds to build a chapel in order to ensure that a Sabbath school be developed in the Lake Avenue area. In the beginning, those early Sabbath schools were organized in a very simple fashion. Two groups were designated. All the children up to age 10 were in the infant class, and the rest were in the main school. The sessions began each Sunday with opening exercises, when all gathered for announcements, singing, and prayers. They would then break into classes for their lessons and reconvene for their closing exercises of more singing, personal prayers, and the superintendent's talk. In the very beginning, the staff of the Sabbath school was chosen from First Baptist Church because they had the leadership ability and the missionary zeal for the venture. But by 1870, the leadership of the school was transferred to those who were still members of First Baptist Church but lived in the Lake Avenue neighborhood. It's interesting to note that by 1871, when the church was formed, most of the leadership of the Sabbath school were those assuming the direction of the church. However, They remained two entities and were totally separate from one another. The Sabbath school had its own constitution, officers, and monies that were held separately from the church. At the end of his first 4 months of service as its pastor, Ebenezer Nisbet became the superintendent of the Sabbath school, a position that he held until he resigned from the church in 1875. This began the process of tying the two entities more closely together, but it would not be fully accomplished until the mid-20th century. By 1865, Rochester First Baptist had established five Sabbath schools, and one of the most important components of the Sabbath school was its library. Between the five schools, there was a competition to see who held the most books. Since its beginning in 1865, the Sabbath school was held at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. This continued after the church was formed in 1871. And on September 5th, 1875, the Sabbath school teachers and officers met with the church officers to determine if the Sabbath school hour should be changed. It was then voted that the Sabbath school would meet at 12 o'clock p.m. immediately following worship, another step in bringing these two entities closer together. The first series of lessons that were adopted by the Sabbath school was a series of lessons published in the Examiner and Chronicle. The Examiner and Chronicle dates from 1854, and the editor was a Baptist and had the cooperation of the best writers in the Baptist denomination. In fact, there was a Sunday school feature that was produced by Edward Eggleston, who was the editor of the National Sunday School Teacher. He was a Methodist teacher, laborer, circuit rider, and writer of children's stories, and a literary editor. Other Sunday school materials were in use at the time. The Young Reapers was published by the American Baptist Publication Society, and the children's paper was published by the American Tract Society, founded in 1852. The Youth's Temperance Banner was published by the National Temperance Society and Publication House. The society was founded in 1865 after a non-denominational conference held in Saratoga Springs, New York. In addition to the curriculum, music in the form of group singing was an important part of Sunday school. During this time, the LABC Sunday School was using such books as Bradbury's Fresh Laurel from the Sabbath School and Royal Diadem for the Sunday School. It was in 1884 that a new building behind the original chapel was completed, and the chapel was given to the Baptist Union and moved to Cameron Street to establish the Lyle Avenue Sabbath School Mission, and on March 2, 1884, the Sunday School held a farewell service before physically moving into the new building. The new building included an auditorium, which was used by the Sunday School for opening and closing exercises. Nationally, there was a movement towards graded lesson plans as opposed to uniform materials for all groups. In an 1893 to 1894, LABC Sunday School adopted the Blakesley lesson plans, which were graded for different age groups, kindergarten, primary, intermediate, and adult. We are blessed in our archives to hold a number of images from these various classes. From the very beginning, careful Sunday school records of membership and attendance were kept. And beginning in 1901, at the end of every school year, during Children's Day, the children would advance to the next level come fall. It was a tradition that has lasted ever since. And beginning the next year, Rally Day would kick off the start of a new Sunday school year. It is within these first 30 years that we discover a commitment to Christian education that continues to this day. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. As a product of a mission, Lake Avenue Baptist Church has at its core itself a call to mission. And over its history, it has commissioned, launched, and supported various foreign and home missionaries. William McIntyre Lisley, born in Huron, Ohio, educated at Granville College in Granville, Ohio, and then in the fall of 1864, entered Newton Theological Seminary. Following completion of his work at Rochester Theological Seminary, he was commissioned to Lake Avenue Baptist School Mission, and from there he committed his life to foreign missions, primarily from New York to Bangkok, Siam. After an illness sent him back to the United States, he and his wife were able to take up the first collection for Baptist Foreign Missions in California, and then he served churches before his death. Next, we have Dr. David Downey, who was born in Glasgow, Scotland, July 28, 1838. And then in April 1854, baptized at Central Baptist Church in New York City. Downey had heard the educational pioneer and missionary to India speak, and it left an impression. Following his education at Phillips Academy in Massachusetts, he went to Brown University, which was founded by Baptists. Following a time at Rochester Theological Seminary, he served at Lake Avenue Baptist, and when it was formed into a church, he served as church clerk until 1873. From Lake Avenue, he served as a missionary at Lenore Mission in India. After 54 years of mission service in India, he returned to the United States and passed away at age 89. Next in our series of missionaries, we have Martha Perry, born in Port Hope, Ontario, Canada. In 1869, she moved to Rochester with her parents and joined Lake Avenue Baptist Church in 1872. She married John Craig, and in 1878, they sailed for India. Next in line, we have Jenny Waite. Jenny was born in New York City in 1851. Her family was part of the original 89 members that were dismissed from First Baptist Church to form Lake Avenue Baptist Church. In 1883, she was appointed by the Women's Baptist Foreign Mission Society to join the Downies in Nellore, India. In 1897, she married Frank D. Finney, a man who was head of American Baptist Mission Press in Rangoon, Burma. Jenny died June 6, 1929, and is buried at the Mount Hope Cemetery. Next, we have Ida Woodward, born in Philadelphia. In 1877, she joined Lake Avenue Baptist Church and became a teacher in the Sunday school. In her youth, Ida was introduced to Susan B. Anthony and spent the first day of their acquaintanceship with Ida rowing Miss Anthony around Sodus Bay. Ida was also good friends with Dr. Martin Brewer Anderson, the first president of the University of Rochester. After her marriage to Reverend Haygooney, Woodward and Haygooney set sail for Constantinople. And after the time in Constantinople and serving churches in the United States, she died in 1948. She too is buried at Mount Hope Cemetery. Next up, we have Lillian Clark Case. Born in Alden, New York, she attended school at the Brockport State School. She joined Lake Avenue Baptist Church March 3, 1884. And in 1884, the Women's Baptist Foreign Mission Society sent her to Rangoon, Burma. She married John Case, and together they opened a new mission station in Mieang, Burma. And later they had two sons, Brayton and Russell. Brayton founded the Pien Mana Agricultural School in Burma in 1923. After time back home, the Cases returned to Burma to the Henzada Mission. Next we have Jenny Edmonds, born in Renfrew, Ontario, Canada. She came to Rochester to attend the Rochester Homeopathic Nursing Training School. This was followed by training at the Huron Road Hospital in Cleveland. She joined Lake Avenue Baptist in 1894. The Women's Baptist Foreign Missionary Society sent her to the Congo River in Africa. Next, we have Stacy Warburton, born in Pawtucket, Rhode Island. He was a graduate of Brown University and Rochester Theological Seminary. In 1902, he married Edith Thompson. Both had a great focus and deep concern for foreign missions. Particularly significant about Warburton is that in 1902, he was hired by Lake Avenue Baptist Church as a pastor on the foreign mission field. They served as missionaries to China. Following a return to the United States, Warburton served as the editor for the Mission Magazine of American Baptist Foreign Mission Society. He was then called to Berkeley Divinity School as professor of Christian missions. 1871 to 1901, called to serve, called to missions. In 1871, in asking permission to organize a church, We are not moved by ambitious motive nor partisan spirit, but nothing but the glory of God and a love for his cause will induce us to sever this relationship. And so it was that 89 members of First Baptist Church were dismissed to join with 17 others to form what would be known as Lake Avenue Memorial Baptist Church and Society, dedicated as a memorial to peace. March 4th, 1871, in the minutes of the Board of Trustees, a music committee consisting of 3 members was formed. On March 28th of that year, the music committee reported that they have conferred with Miss Bull in reference to playing, quote, the instrument, and she promised that she would consider it. It was later in February 1789 that there was approved repairs to the instrument, and we can make conclusion that that instrument was an organ. In a rather humorous note from 1873, Deacon Woodbury, a founding member, wrote in a letter, quote, to lead in vocal part, we had a chorus made up of such as were willing to give their gratuitous services. The suffering of the faithful who listened to such music week after week can better be imagined than described. Deacon Woodbury admits that he was a member of said chorus. With a desire to improve congregational singing, the trustee minutes from September 19, 1876, read, resolved that the music committee be instructed to devise some method to improve the singing of the congregation, if a leader can be obtained from amongst the congregation, or to see Mrs. Bird, the organist, on the matter. April 22nd, 1878. We have a record in the trustee moments of a letter by 4 members of the choir indicating that they felt they could not continue without, quote, the aid and drill of competent leadership. They therefore indicated that they would suspend themselves from the organization, and after considerable discussion, it was decided that the choir appoint a committee to take the singing question into consideration. On April 26, 1878, a special meeting was held to receive the report of the Committee on Singing that interviewed a number of different singers, among them Mr. H. W. Warden, who was highly recommended. His terms were $200 per year for leading the church choir and Sunday school. He sang several pieces, after which they decided to give him a trial for 4 Sundays. Between May and July of 1878, there was transition in who served as the organist. First Miss Gorsline, and then Mr. Robert Lyle, who earned $100 per year to play the organ for the church and Sabbath school, and to lead the singing. January 6, 1879, Brother Charles Robinson offered to lead the choir and continue the present system of congregational singing. But just a month later, trustees informed Brother Robinson that it would be, quote, unwise to organize a choir at this time. On February 2nd, 1882, it appears that there were 2 organs at the time. The trustees approved both the organ in the audience room and the young people's room be repaired. And by 1884, the organist was paid $150 per year. Trustees moved to confer with the Sabbath school superintendent, requesting that the Sabbath school then pay part of the organist's salary. December 6, 1886, trustees moved that the associated young people be allowed to host a concert on December 21st, presented by the Fisk Jubilee Singers. It was at that same meeting that the Board of Trustees moved to allow the Band of Hope to hold weekly meetings in the lecture room. The Band of Hope was formed to teach young people the importance of the principles of sobriety. On October 10, 1890, the Board of Trustees entered into a contract with the Emmons Howard Organ Company to build an organ to be installed in the new church edifice the following year. The new organ was described as having 26 registers, 1,214 pipes, a great organ with a swell organ, a pedal organ, mechanical registers, and pedal movements. It cost $3,000. On March 6, 1891, the music committee purchased 125 Gospel Hymns No. 5. On March 6, 1891, George Fisher was hired as the church organist, a position he would hold until 1926. He was known as the, quote, Dean of Organists in Rochester. On November 3, 1892, there was Ye Old Folks Concert held. The folk in the picture are not old folks, but rather young folks dressed in old folks' costumes. It can be assumed that they dressed up that day to sing a concert of music for their parents' and grandparents' generations. It was on December 4, 1894, that Herman Dassenbach played for the LABC Monthly Social. That was the beginning of a relationship between the Dassenbach musical configurations and LABC that lasted well into the 1920s. January 3, 1896, the choir presented St. Nicholas, a Christmas cantata. Here we have a picture from December 1898 to January 1899 of the salaries due to the choir. And finally, on December 2, 1902, we have here a picture of the inaugural organ recital from the new memorial organ that was held. Mr. Charles Hamm gave the instrument in memory of his wife, Mary Hamm. LABC has a long history of valuing music in its worship and in the life of the church. We look forward to seeing what will come in our next 30 years. In 1844, the Baptist Triennial Convention took what was then a bold social justice stance on the issue of slavery. The convention voted to forbid the commissioning of missionaries who were slaveholders. And yet 30 years later, the resulting Northern Baptist movement continued to refuse to address the pressing social issue of women's rights and the commissioning of women as missionaries on home or foreign mission fields. But that changed in 1877, when the women of the Northern Baptist movement formed the American Baptist Women's Foreign Mission Society, followed shortly by the establishment of the Women's Home Mission Society. Then, in 1881, they went one step further. They founded the Baptist Missionary Training School in Chicago, Illinois, specifically to train women for the mission field and other church professions. From 1877 to 1972, the societies commissioned women missionaries to serve across the United States and around the world. In a June 1927 interview, Miss Anna Thomas, the first secretary treasurer of the LABC Foreign Mission Society, indicates that though the earliest books were lost, our Foreign Mission Society here at LABC was founded around 1871 or 1872. The earliest written records we have come from the treasurer's book, 1873. Originally, the LABC Foreign Mission Society had 21 members. Each woman was given a Foreign Mission Society mission box in which she would place 2 cents a week, and at the end of the year, those boxes were collected and all the money was given to foreign missionary work. And although there was no home mission society in LABC or in Baptist life in Rochester, all of our money was divided by foreign and home missions. After 1877, most of the members subscribed to The Helping Hand, a missionary magazine published by the Women's Baptist Foreign Mission Society. Some also subscribed to Tidings, which was a publication of the Women's Home Mission Society, and the reading of the two kept local church societies connected to the work across the country and around the world. At the same time the Foreign Mission Society was formed in 1873, the Ladies' Social Society was formed, and in 1878 the church was still meeting in the chapel building that had been built as a Sabbath school. Pictured here is the 1898 Constitution of the Ladies' Social Society. And although the exact date is not known, the women of the church also formed a Dorcas Society. The society met as necessary to sew for the needy of the church. In 1910, when the Women's Mission Society moved to the circle model, the Dorcas Society was invited to join the societies as a circle, and after much discussion, the Dorcas Society became the Dorcas Circle. In 1879 to 1880, Miss Mary Burdett brought 2 home missionaries to Rochester, and this piqued our women in the interest of the Home Mission Society. Miss Burdett was the secretary of the Women's American Baptist Home Mission Society. In 1881, the society established the Baptist Missionary Training School in Chicago. Mary was appointed the superintendent, a position she held for 6 years. She edited the Society's publication, Tidings, and traveled throughout the U.S. and wrote numerous articles on Home Mission Society, including to Mexico and Cuba. When she died, she left her home in D.C. to the Society, which in turn was used as the National Training School for Girls in Washington. That same year, the LABC Societies became supportive of the work being done in the South by Joanna Moore. She originally became involved with the free slaves. She taught reading and writing, and was the first missionary to be commissioned by the Women's Baptist Home Mission Society. She founded the School for Black Women in Louisiana and established fireside schools and home for the aged black women. 1881-82, the societies introduced the mission teas held at the parsonage. Luncheon was held at noon, followed by quilting, patchwork aprons, little dresses, and a collection of goods contributed by the ladies. Here we have the expense line for a barrel purchased by the Women's Missionary Society and sent to Joanna P. Moore, full of goods. It's recorded that they also sent money to Miss Jeannie Wyatt, missionary, to Nellore, India. We also have indication that money and goods were sent to missionaries in West China, to places in the South, to amongst the, quote, Indians, as well as to a prison literature committee where money and goods were distributed amongst wives and children of convicts. Although there is not a definitive record, it appears that the two societies, foreign and home, merged into one organization sometime in the 1890s. And by 1898 to 1899, the society had established reading circles that may have been a precursor to adopting the circle method of organization in 1910. The women of our early mission societies is far too numerous to list. We are so thankful for the impact that they have had and the foundation that they have laid for the many years to come. Throughout the history of Lake Avenue Baptist Church, young people have been incredibly important. It is unclear exactly when the church began to do ministry specifically with young people. However, we know that by 1884 or 1885, there was what was called the Young People's Meetings being held. Here we have the inside of a Young People's Meeting pamphlet. In the minutes of the Board of Trustees, it's recorded that the, quote, Associated Young People requested the use of the auditorium to host a concert presented by the Fisk Jubilee Singers from Fisk College in Nashville. Reverend Francis Clark was a congregational pastor in Portland, Maine. On a bitter cold Sunday evening in February 1881, 57 young people gathered at the church for their regular youth meeting. After a general conversation, Dr. Clark proposed the establishment of a society to be called the Williston Young People's Society of Christian Endeavor. The purpose was to promote the earnest Christian life, to increase members' mutual acquaintance, and to make them more useful in the service of God. This was the beginning of the Christian Endeavor movement that spread around the world and throughout multiple denominations. Dr. Clark would become known as the Father of Youth Ministry. The movement exists to this day, training young people for leadership in the church. In 1895, the calendar section of the Weekly Worship Bulletin, we find the first evidence of the Christian Endeavor movement being established at LABC. However, it would appear that it was actually established earlier, with Thursday evening being their regular meeting time. And in December of 1895, the Christian Endeavor sponsored a church social following the Physical Culture Club. Weekly announcements of the Christian Endeavor meeting continues up through 1901. In the weekly calendar for the week of December 3rd, 1899, we find an anomaly. For Friday, it says that there is a meeting listed as the Women's Meeting in the Furtherance of the Cause of Missions. That is followed by the Young People's Meeting of the same cause. One could raise the question, is this the Young People's Group that was established in the 1880s, or is this the Young People's Christian Endeavor Club? This is likely lost to history. Dr. Deborah Van Broekhoven of the American Baptist Historical Society postulates that the earliest American Baptist picnics developed around the 4th of July celebrations in the 1800s. Initially, the 4th of July picnics were political and oftentimes drunken celebrations, so the family picnic was likely a pushback against said. It is also known that by the 1840s, abolitionists began holding family-friendly picnics. It may be that the Sabbath school picnic was an outgrowth of this pushback. Although the records show that Sunday school picnics actually started in 1865, before LABC became a chartered church, this picture from 1886 is the first picture of the Sunday school picnic, which was held at Newport House. This picture is from 1891 and a Sunday school picnic in Seneca Park. And here we find a receipt for Mrs. McMillan for the Lake Avenue Baptist Church for transportation of 200 adults for that Sunday school picnic. Here in 1894, this year the picnic required transportation on the Grandview Beach Railroad. Where it took place, we don't know. And here we find a receipt for transportation to Silver Lake for the 1895 Sunday School picnic. This transportation was provided by the Buffalo, Rochester, and Pittsburgh Railroad Company. In 1896, the Sunday School picnic was again held at Silver Lake, and again transportation was used by the Buffalo, Rochester, and Pittsburgh Railroad Company. It wasn't until 1901 that the Sunday School picnic was held at Seabreeze. This is just the beginning of a value on youth ministry that would continue throughout the years. And church picnics were another way for the community to gather together and celebrate the significance of youth. Deacon Doty, one of the earliest deacons at Lake Avenue Baptist Church, was a man who had vision and breadth of mind. When the Lake Avenue Baptist Church, in the fall of 1890, was considering the matter of calling to the pastorate a brilliant youth, Clarence Barber, then only 23 years of age, who was beginning his senior year at the Rochester Theological Seminary, the question was raised as to whether or not it was wise to call so young of a man to so important a position. It was Deacon Doty who responded, "Time will remedy that matter," and it did. In that question, there was the value and the significance of youth. And we know that through that decision and through the decisions of so many over the years, the significance and value of youth continues to this day.